Last month's protests swept through Brazil's cities, bringing hundreds of thousands onto the streets to protest rampant political corruption, declining government services, and rising public costs. Contrary to the rosy economic picture the World Bank and IMF have tried to paint over the past decade, Brazil's growing discontent with the neoliberal model is now on full display. This is the GRTV Backgrounder on Global Research TV. People around the world watched in amazement last month as hundreds of thousands of protesters flooded into the streets of Brazil cities. The movement, as awe-inspiring as it was unexpected, caught many by surprise and captivated the world media for weeks, prompting much speculation as to what was behind these protests in the first place.
It's always been a source of Brazilian pride, and soccer fans in Rio are still celebrating their team's every goal. But this national obsession has now become a potent symbol of Brazil's problems as the country prepares to host the biggest tournament of all, the World Cup, next year.
You're obviously a big football fan, but do you think it's worth the money? I mean, billions being spent on the World Cup.
No, for sure not. It's like a lot of money for such a little event, so we have more another priorities that they just ignored about it.
So the protests actually started a couple of weeks ago against rising bus fares and the cost of hosting the World Cup next year and the Olympics in 2016. For many Brazilians, coping with transport costs is already incredibly difficult, so even a seemingly small rise in bus fares of 20 cents is actually a big deal.
Last Friday, President Dilma Rousseff gave a public speech where she mentioned topics like health and corruption. Her declarations were considered vague by the population that demand a more decisive plan and continued demonstrating over the weekend all around Brazil.
And Mark, let's start off with, I just named a bunch of reasons why, that we've heard of why these people are having these demonstrations. Can you whittle it down for us? Is there really one thing that this boils down to?
No, I don't think so. And I think it isn't clear because it's a mixture of people with different demands and complaints. And, the media.
Everyone agrees that the recent protests were sparked by price rises that tipped public ire past the boiling point. But there remains disagreement over what brought the public to that boiling point in the first place. Part of the problem is that the very existence of these protests seems to counter the mainstream narrative that Brazil has been a model of economic growth over the past decade, and that the ruling Workers' Party represents a government that cares about the economic and social plight of its people.
After spending the first day of his visit focused on expanding U.S.-Brazil economic and trade ties, the president and his family spent time seeing some key sites in Rio de Janeiro. But one of those stops, a visit to the large favela or slum known as City of God, also buttressed a key message that inclusion of people from all levels of society and all races strengthens democracy and furthers development and economic progress.
The mainstream narrative of Brazil holds that the country has undergone a remarkable economic transformation over the past decade, spurred by its growing trade with China in an increasingly important intra-BRICS trade. This has led to an impressive array of statistics. A steadily increasing GDP growth rate that topped out at 9% in the first quarter of 2010. A decline in those living below the poverty line to less than 2.2%. A stabilization of inflation rates to the 5-6% range. As Professor Michel Chosadovsky points out in a recent article, however, these statistics are fudged, designed to give the impression that a booming Brazilian economy has translated unproblematically into a growing middle class and respect for the government. As these protests show, that impression is a lie. Late last month, Michel Chosadovsky of the Center for Research on Globalization joined us to discuss the roots of the current Brazilian unrest and how it relates to rising economic tensions across much of the developed world.
Well, we have to go back to the instatement or inauguration of Luiz Ignacio da Silva, Lula, to the presidency of Brazil in the year 2003. At that time, people were actually expecting it. There was a mass movement that Lula would reverse the tide, which was characterized by neoliberal economic policy, the IMF, Wall Street largely determining the course of government spending and investment. But in fact, what happened was exactly the reverse. Lula's election indeed embodied the hope of an entire nation, but what he did was essentially embrace the IMF economic medicine, and he was commended by none other than the managing director of the IMF at the time, Horst Köhler, who later became the president of Germany. And he said, you know, Lula, actually what they said is Lula is our president, meaning that he was the president of the chosen by the IMF and not by the Brazilian people. And he expressed his support for Lula. He said, this is the best president that we've had. Yeah, this is the best president we've had. And in effect, what was implemented as of 2003 was a whole series of economic and social reforms, which essentially were conducive to impoverishing large sectors of the population, including the middle class. Now, this is not the established conventional wisdom from whatever sector of society we examine. The left, let's say the European left at the time, but also the Brazilian left, supported Lula and essentially viewed his instatement as the end of an era. There was a lot of division within his party. There were people opposed to his measures, but essentially what happened is that the Lula government handed over the reins of macroeconomic reform and central banking to Wall Street, typically, and this is very important. The head of the Central Bank of Brazil at the time was Enrique de Campos Meirelles, and he so happened to be the CEO of Boston Fleet, which eventually was bought up by Bank America. Now, really what that means is you're appointing one of the top Wall Street executives to head the country's monetary policy. And what we are witnessing today is, first of all, people across Brazil have risen up against the economic policies of this self-proclaimed socialist government, which heralds itself as an alternative to neoliberalism, when in fact it has consistently adopted strong economic medicine in the course of the last 10 years since the instatement of Lula in January of 2003.
As roving correspondent and Brazilian-born journalist Pepe Escobar confirms, the official statistics regarding the Brazilian economy have been fudged, and the current government is a technocratic one that functions by balancing lip service of social and economic equality with an accommodating environment for foreign capital and speculative investment in a neoliberal economic model.
In terms of neoliberalism, yes, the Workers' Party, Lula especially, less with Dilma, she's a more a statist, let's put it this way. But Lula was a darling in Wall Street. Brazil was neoliberal for the 8 years of Lula, remains significantly neoliberal under Dilma, with a little more space for state-owned enterprises as well. But, you know, this in terms of the fundamentals of the system, how it works all over the world, Brazil is absolutely part of it. It's not trying an experiment like Bolivia, for instance, or it's not trying something like Venezuela, and not to mention Cuba. No way. So in economic terms, until virtually yesterday, Brazil was a paradise for international investors, because in terms of hot money flowing into the São Paulo Stock Exchange, it's absolutely crazy. It's one of the best returns you can have on the planet. As soon as the Fun Fest was not as good as it was until, let's say, a year ago, it's very simple. You just need to read the Financial Times and The Economist. They start bashing Dilma directly, in fact, because they said, now Brazil is going to become a statist paradise like the old Soviet Union. You know, that's ridiculous. Because until virtually yesterday, a lot of people were making a lot of money with hot money flowing into the Brazilian economy, especially in the Brazilian stock exchange, not the Brazilian economy. It was not productive investment. So now it's not anymore. And of course, they have to fight inflation. Real inflation, they say it's a 3, 4, or 5. In fact, people in Brazil tell me all the time, real life inflation is over 25-30%. They compare the price of tomatoes or potatoes 3 months ago to what they're paying now. And yes, it's 25-30%, the real inflation that people actually feel. So it's a balancing act. You have to be neoliberal. You have to be facilitating state-owned enterprise investment. You have to control inflation, but you have to please international investors. You have to try to diminish inequality and at the same time don't leave everything, ultra-hot economy going everywhere. It's a very complicating balancing act. So for the Dilma government, it's the maturity is now. How to organize all these problems. And many of these problems were left by Lula. Lula was thinking about the big picture. He was traveling all over the world, and he was selling Brazil insertion in this very rarefied group of world powers that have influence globally. He managed to do that. He succeeded in that. But he left the day-to-day management of the country with a bunch of people, and some of them are either incompetent or corrupt or both.
Indeed, whatever the proximate cause of this most recent round of unrest in Brazil, one positive that can be gleaned from this experience is that the Brazilian people have demonstrated not only that they have political muscles that can be flexed, but that they know how to use them. At the very least, the government will not be able to proceed so blithely with the understanding that their actions will be supported by the vast, silent majority of the population, or that the public will be bought off by doctored official statistics about Brazil's booming economy that somehow never seems to change the plight of the average Brazilian worker. For many, 2013 will be seen as a turning point in the relations between the Brazilian people and their government. For the time being, it seems the pendulum of political power is swinging once again toward the side of the public. It remains to be seen if this leverage can be used to oust the neoliberal predators from control of the nation's economy. For more on this story and other breaking news and current events, please go to globalresearch.ca. For more research and analysis by James Corbett, please go to corbettreport.com. The Center for Research on Globalization depends on your support. To purchase a book or DVD, or to make a donation, please visit globalresearch.ca today.